Ambassador Cunningham, thank you for your time.
Glad to see you.
We are in the middle of a very tense political environment at this stage. The UN has proposed the Election Commission criteria for invalidation of votes, and the UN said that it has, quote-unquote, the full international backing. Is that something the US government has supported as well?
Yes, we have. So you know, the agreement between the candidates was to conduct the audit under UN supervision with a very active UN role. I'm pleased to say that the Commission last night adopted the final set of the proposals and procedures that the UN put forward based on consultations, actually very intensive consultations with the candidates. The UN proposal doesn't meet 100% the concerns of either candidate, but it is the best effort by the UN experts to create the final part of the proposals that's necessary for the audit and then for the invalidation procedures to go forward. So we're glad that they've been adopted, and we look forward to resumption of the audit on Saturday.
And that's non-negotiable? That's a done deal?
That's done, as far as we're concerned, yes.
Camp Abdullah has said that it has its own flaws and cannot marginalize the fraudulent votes. And they're threatening to boycott the process. Is that something which worries the United States?
Well, we've been in contact with them, of course, over the past week, as well as with the Ghani camp. As I said, this is the best effort by the best elections experts to meet the concerns of both candidates and to find a way forward that will provide the best chance of success for the audit. We believe that that task has been done after a lot of hard work by the UN experts, and we encourage both candidates to go forward with the audit that they committed to in the agreement.
You said you encourage them, but you cannot force them, of course, to accept
it. Well, nobody can force them to do anything. But they agreed to have this 100% audit of the ballot boxes. They agreed to accept the outcome of the audit, and they agreed and welcomed the UN role in supervision, which is a very important component of assuring the credibility of the audit. The UN is working hard to fulfill that role. It's the only body that can do that, and they have the full support, I think it's safe to say, not just of the United States, but of the rest of the international community.
But Mr. Ambassador, this is not the best case scenario. I mean, the candidates, as you said, have their own concerns, so we could achieve a better deal.
I don't think there is a better deal. I can assure you that over a period of some 10 days or 2 weeks, in very careful, detailed discussions with both candidates and their teams, the UN experts made every effort that they could to meet the concerns of both of the candidates, consistent with international best practices. We support the proposal that's been made. We support going forward with the audit on that basis. And we urge both the candidates also to do so.
Now, with the concerns in place, of course, about the criteria, should the Afghan people be worried about one candidate stepping out of the process and putting the country back into a square one?
I hope that won't happen. Both candidates have a stake now in going through the only process that's available to produce an outcome to the elections and to validate that outcome. That's the basic premise of the framework agreement that they agreed to. That bringing the UN expertise and role to bear is a way to strengthen and support the elections commissions in the job that they legally have to perform. The basis for that is now fully prepared. Most of it had been done earlier, but the procedures are now fully in place to do that. And again, we urge both the candidates to go forward on the basis that they agreed. They asked for the UN to play this role. The UN is doing its best to do so. They bring the best expertise and the most neutral expertise to bear on the process. and they've worked hard with the candidates to meet as many of their concerns as they can, again, consistent with international best practices.
But you're not confident that they would accept the ground rule now?
I hope they will. I very much hope that they will.
You said you're not confident.
I don't know. I haven't heard a reaction from them. This, the procedures were just adopted last night. Both the candidates are still out of the country. I hope when they return and consult with their teams that they'll agree to go forward, as they had told the UN that they would do, by the way, several days ago.
So if this is the ground rule, the IEC would start resume auditing on Saturday. And is there any indication that how much time would it take to finish?
That depends very much on the pace of the audit, which needs to be accelerated from a rather slow beginning, which was expected because of it's been a learning process for everybody going through this. This is a very unique kind of experience. No election has ever been audited like this before with this kind of scope. But the original estimate was that the audit would be able to go through 1,000 boxes a day once it was fully up and running. We hope that they will get to that stage in the near future, and then we'll have a better, once we see what the pace is, the maximum pace that they can perform, then we'll have a better idea how long the audit will take. But we hope it will be possible to conclude it in 4 weeks or 5 weeks.
That means by the middle of September we have...
Well, we had originally hoped to have it done before the end of August. So that is still our goal, because we would like, as the candidates would like, to have a president inaugurated before the NATO summit in the beginning of September. But we'll have a better idea in a week or so if that goal can be met.
We talked about the technical side of it, but there was a political agreement reached between the two candidates, brokered by Secretary Kerry. One very unique aspect of it is the establishment of the Chief Executive's Office. What is your analysis of that position? How powerful that position is in the incoming government?
Well, that's the agreement does call for the president to create that position, chief executive officer, but it does not describe what that position will do or what its powers are, and that's something that the candidates will have to discuss further, as they will many other aspects of the political agreement. The political agreement is a framework. It sets out general principles, but it doesn't resolve or address many of the details that will be needed to actually form the what's called the national unity government. So we believe that those discussions need to begin soon, so that important details like that can be elaborated, fleshed out. But one thing is clear, though, just to be clear, there's nothing in the framework agreement that establishes or suggests that there will be a parliamentary form of government. It's clear that the government will remain as it is under the Afghan constitution, a presidential form of government, with the president having the authority over the government.
So there is no head of state, head of government split?
There isn't a split. There's a president, a chief executive officer, which may eventually become a prime minister. That will depend on experience and the Aloya Jirga, if that's the will of the people. And there's another position created called leader of the opposition, but it's not really an opposition in the parliamentary sense. It's meant to signify the person who is the runner-up in the election will have a role in the government as a partner, and that's what the nature of the unity government agreement is about. It's about how to create partnership and cooperation between the two candidates after a winner is determined by the audit.
But how can you have a head of opposition and at the same time head of government?
It's probably not the best term. because it implies that there is it implies that there is an opposition, which is not really the intent of the framework. The intent of the framework is to provide and promote cooperation between the two candidates and their teams after the winner of the election is known. So the those positions will relate to each other in a cooperative relationship in the future is something that the candidates will have to work out.
Mr. Ambassador, how was your reaction when you heard from the IEC that there was an 8.1 million voters in the second round?
Well, it's, there were 8.1 million votes, ballots. Actually, I think I thought the number was less than 8 million, but it doesn't really matter. The nobody knows. Everybody knows that there was some fraud committed on both sides of the campaign, but nobody knows what the degree of the fraud is. And that's the, that's what the purpose
it,
of the
was
audit.
Was it better in 2009, or was it worse in 2000?
I don't know. I wasn't here in 2009. I'm not going to comment on what happened in the past. The point is, nobody really knows for fact what happened in the election, what the outcome is. One of the few things that is undoubtedly true, though, is whatever the scale of the fraud, which the audit has to determine. Whatever the scale of the fraud, what is undoubtedly true is that there were many millions of valid ballots cast in the election. Under the worst possible scenario, many more valid votes than invalid votes. And that is an important principle behind the audit as well, that it's important to recognize the millions of Afghans who went to the polls and cast their votes. The election in most parts of the country went as it was supposed to, and the institutions performed well, and the people came out in very large numbers to vote. So all those things happened, and the legitimacy of those votes needs to be recognized.
And who is responsible for the electoral mess? Of course not the people who braved and the Taliban threatened and voted.
That's not for me to say. I won't comment on that. There are lots of accounts of what happened in various
places.
Was
President Karzai partial in the election?
President Karzai has consistently maintained and that he is partial in the elections, that he's been neutral and that he wants the election process to run the way it's intended to run. And I think he has he's maintained a very useful role in encouraging the candidates to follow through with the election process, to begin a political dialogue, and encouraging the commissions to perform their duty, their function.
My last question, Mr. Ambassador. What are the lessons learned from the 2014 elections?
Well, I hope that at the end of this process, although it has been flawed in some respects, I hope that the Afghan people will see, as I said, that for many millions of Afghans, the elections worked as they were supposed to. Millions of people went out to vote. The process functioned properly, and there are millions of legitimate votes in the system. The exact lessons learned, I think, will be for people to look at after this process is completed and after there is an outcome and a president in office. Part of the an important part of the political framework is the commitment of both candidates to a reform agenda. And that includes electoral reform. And I think they both acknowledge that means needs to be found to try to figure out what didn't work this time around institutionally and to fix that before the next elections.
Mr. Ambassador, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.